Black Knight.
Hi guys, my name's Rich. I'm one of the co-founders of Streetdancemixes.com. I've been cutting and mixing music for dance for about 15 years now, and I'm presenting this webinar in association with the team at Dance Teacher Hub, who have seriously got you covered with resources and advice in every area of running a dance school or class. So if you're not a member, I suggest you join up ASAP. My company, Streetdancemixes, exists to provide great music to busy dance teachers in a simple, legal and inspirational way. It's simple in that you can find what you want using an easy search engine, purchase the track, download it and own it. No software installation or going back and forth with an expensive editor. Just download what you need and start your rehearsals. It's totally legal as we report all sales to the PRS and MCPS who pay royalties to the original artists. And it's inspirational because we hope you guys will stumble across music you may not have thought to use before. If you want more backstory on me and my organisation, there's a great interview over on Dance Teacher Hub that you can read that we did a while back. This webinar today, though, is about giving you guys some tips and skills and some general thoughts about ensuring that the music that you use accentuates all of the hard work that you've already put into your choreography. So, to use an example, you could be the best race car driver in the world, but if the car itself doesn't go very well, then you're never going to get to realise your full potential. As Len Goodman said once on Strictly Come Dancing, dance without music is just movement, and it's the other musical half of this whole that we're looking to tidy up and make slick so that you guys can concentrate on just creating awesome choreography. So all it's going to take is a little bit of forethought and planning, and that can not only improve your show, but your classes in general, your students' experience of both class and show, and it will really help to take the pressure off of you when it gets down to showtime. So I'm talking about show or review music in this lesson specifically. Competition music has a slightly different set of rules and requirements, so maybe we'll do another one of these webinars one day to address just that. So, as far as shows are concerned, let's move on to your first opportunity to use music to your advantage, and that's house music. And I don't mean the genre of house, I mean the music that's playing as the audience come in to take their seats. Now, many dance shows I've been to don't have house music at all. I guess it's all about the choreo for them, and that's fair enough, but I think we should remember that we have paying spectators who are there for a complete experience, and that experience should start from the minute that they walk into the venue. And music's a great way to communicate with your audience and let them know that they're part of this whole event, this show, and it's going to be special and memorable. So they might as well get on board and get involved. So a show I filmed recently had no house music playing. There was kids running around, adults stood in groups, chatting, checking phones. Then the dance school owner popped her head round the curtain and sort of meekly announced, "Oh, the show's starting in 2 minutes." And people took their seats, and then 3 or 4 minutes went by and the kids started running round again. The adults started chatting again, checking their phones again. Then the curtains opened and the show sort of slowly and painfully got to a start. playing music is free. It doesn't cost anything. And, you know, thinking of a few tracks that get the audience in the right mood for the whole show, it only takes a couple of minutes on your part. Just add them to the playlist and off you go. So something that I might use might be Good Time by Owl City and Kylie Rae Jepsen. That would get them in the mood. Or Rather Be by Clean Bandit, No Place I'd Rather Be. They're good examples of songs that I might use to get everyone in a good mood and keep them entertained until the show's about to start. Then in the run-up to the show starting, I'd play a track that's going to sit all of those spectators down and let them know that their full attention is now required. So, you know, play that a little bit louder, make everyone realise something's about to happen. We need their attention, and if they're willing to give it, then something truly amazing is going to unfold before their very eyes. It's kind of, I don't know if you've ever been to Disney, but it's kind of the way that before you get on the roller coaster, there's videos, and, you know, while you're in the queue, there's all sorts of things amping up what the experience is about to be. So what I'm going to do now is show you an example from a show that I did recently of how we raise an audience's attentiveness and expectations for the show. There's a sponsorship shout out section in here, followed by a short film that took us about a day to shoot and edit, but hopefully you'll see why this was worth it. So it's a film of the crew that start the show, and the crew that are featured in that film, as it ends, that's when they take to the stage and the whole show starts. So I'll play you that video now and see what you think. We'll be right back.
voices in my head. I'm attacking the illusion by the stopping Jersey man.
But I just gotta know one thing. Are you ready? No! I said, are you ready?
So when that finished, everyone was pretty excited and there was a massive cheer as the team did their first routine, the first slot in the show. So it seems like we were pretty confident with what we were about to present. But the way I see it is, as a dance teacher, why shouldn't you be? There's very few live events you can go and see where that many hours of work have been put into the final result. You've got each one of those, all the choreography you've done, each one of those kids that has been at home rehearsing for hours, the mum that has had to finish the dinner and then drive their child to the dance class, pick them up at the end. Hours, thousands of hours. There must be thousands of hours on stage there, and you should be proud of it, in my opinion. So be confident. What's the alternative? Being apologetic and saying, oh, well, this isn't going to be very good? I don't think so. So moving on, we're going to go to our first section now, which is show music selection. So choosing the right music for your show. Now, there's a million things to think about. I guess it's mostly matching music that is age and skill appropriate to the classes. So maybe not Lil Wayne for your beginner street dance class or what have you. Then there's the balancing act between using that same old high school musical track you've used a million times before versus the latest hardcore underground beats. And the answer lies usually somewhere in the middle of both of those. You know, what's going to excite the kids but at the same time not lose the audience? Remixes are great for this, so we in the audience have got a vocal to hang on to as a spectator, and there's something interesting and cool to dance to beat wise as far as the students are concerned. It's always worth checking out the full single release on iTunes of a track you're using, because quite often they're released with remixes as well. So for like $2.99, you can buy it with 5 extra remixes. Other than that, if you're looking for ideas, subscribe to a blog or a YouTube channel. I quite often check out goodtodance2.com. Over there, they are taking YouTube videos and reposting them in by dance genre as opposed to musical genre, so it's easier to find stuff. Or obviously, just go and search streetdancemixes.com for something that is actually built to dance to. It's got that in mind, so that's an option too. So there's also some crossover with competition considerations when it comes to musicality here. So if the kids in your class can't hit every beat in a complex dubstep track, give them something slower, 4-4, less complicated to work with. And on the flip side to that, if you have got an intricate double time whacking section in a routine performed by an advanced group, then make sure all of those choreographed hit points are backed up with a sound. Dance enables the audience to visualize the music, and if the two don't tie in together properly, then the magic gets a little bit lost. So anyway, next up, show music quality. This has become more of an issue recently with sort of YouTube rips and music blogs doing 96 kbps mp3 downloads. And to understand my objection to poor quality music, I think we have to borrow a phrase from theatre. And that phrase is the suspension of disbelief. So I teach theatre or drama as well as doing this. And whilst individual performance is really important, it just takes one person dropping a prop backstage or something like that to remind me oh yeah, I'm just in a village hall watching a bunch of kids pretending to be someone else. And it's the same in dance. If the music is badly cut or grainy and lo-fi, it draws attention to itself and away from the dancers, where we should be able to forget about it almost completely and just be absorbed into its representation on stage by the company doing the dancing. So for me, 256 kbps, that's what iTunes sell at. That's like the minimum bit rate that I would use for a show. And as for the cutting of that, we'll get onto that really soon. But next up, I'm going to talk about length. Now, the first reason to cut your music is because of audience ADHD, as I like to call it. If you can present two dances of 2 minutes per class, as opposed to 1 4-minute piece, then absolutely everyone's going to have a better time. The students won't be learning endless or repeated choreography. You'll have more variety in your classes, in rehearsals, and the audience are treated to a fast-paced and exciting show. I generally go for about 2 minutes a piece, sometimes less for the little kids, and then maybe more than 2 minutes for intermediate and advanced classes, but I'd hardly ever use the full 5 minute version of anything, except for maybe if they're doing a contemporary piece where the lyrics telling a whole story. Generally though, keep in mind, it's like in TV. Shots and scenes are constantly cutting in order to keep our interest. And all audiences are the same in this regard, and it's our job to keep them interested and continually engaged. So this webinar is not about music mixing, just cutting, but I'd like to show you an example of how a mix can keep the interest and tempo of a show skipping along nicely.
We're here at the concert hall. Looks like the show is about to start.
Miss Twinkle, why are all the instruments separated?
They're separated so that each instrumental family can hear each other more clearly.
Instrumental families?
The brass section. The woodwind section. The string section. The percussion section.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think it's important to note that the routine we just saw was shorter in total than the radio edit of All About That Bass by Meghan Trainor. So packed a lot of excitement in there, and things keep switching up. And a mix like that is the sort of thing that you can find on streetdancemixes.com for about £5. So now I'm going to talk about volume and EQ for your show. So I'm going back to the suspension of disbelief thing here, and I personally can't stand it when a ballerina's graceful landing on the stage is louder than the music. For a complete experience, the music should envelop the performance and the audience. So keep it pretty loud, I would have said. Selling earplugs is a great, and if you put a bit of markup on there, profitable idea that will let you crank up the volume and avoid complaints at the same time. And as far as EQ goes, I'm only really mentioning it as, in my experience, when you've got a big system, it's very tempting to crank the bass really high, swamp out the mid-range, which is usually the frequency that the majority of your choreo is probably tied into. So let's move on to the editing. I'm going to be using Sony Acid to do the editing today. It represents a pretty good compromise between functionality and price. I guess a lot of you will be using GarageBand on a Mac, and what we're about to cover is still relevant to you, and what I'm going to be doing is shortening and ending a track in two ways. Once for those of you who have some kind of beat mapping capability, and then again for those of you that don't. If your software doesn't support some kind of beat mapping, I'd strongly suggest that you invest in something that does. It'll make your edits quicker and easier, and give you much more scope to reorder a track on your timeline. So first up, I'm going to play you a tutorial of a cutdown using software that can beatmap, and after that I'll take you through that same process without beatmapping. This tutorial is pre-recorded and it's aimed at beginner DJs who we were accepting into the site at the time. It's aimed at them, but I think that you'll find it very useful for you too. So if you can afford the $44.95 or whatever it is to buy Acid, I think that's about 30 quid. Like I say, I'd strongly suggest you invest in something that will lock your beats to the grid. So that means you could just choose sections and move them around as you please. If you can't do that, if you can't afford that, or you'd be happier just taking out sections, then we will be. Then I'll run a tutorial after this on how to do that sort of thing without beat mapping software. So I hope you enjoy it. Here we go. Hey guys, Rich from Street Dance Mixes here, and in this tutorial we're going to be shortening a popular song so that dance teachers can provide more routines and variety in their shows, so they've got a shorter piece of music to work with. So the first thing I'm going to do is choose a piece of music, and I'm going to go with Birthday by Katy Perry. I know it might not be the height of the latest EDM trend, but I think it would sell well on the website, and I think that you could do a good themed routine to it with Pass the Parcel, musical chairs, that sort of thing. So I'm just drawing it in to get a feel for how long it is now, and looking at the waveform to see where the main sections are. So first things first, we'll have a listen. So first things first, we'll get this thing beat mapped. Obviously you could do this in a stereo editor because we're only taking out bits of one song, but for me it's going to be a lot easier if I can just cut out chunks that are already beat mapped. So I'm going to quickly beat map this, get it in time, and that's going to make the whole process a lot quicker in the end. So when I'm beat mapping, I like to be very accurate, make sure everything's on point. I'll just go through quickly, tidy that up. Okay. I'm just going to put that back a bit so every cut I make is slightly in front of the beat so I don't lose the transient on that. So that's done. So now we're going to have to have a listen to the whole song, set the right tempo. And what we're going to do now is we're going to listen out for points where we can easily cut out and cut back into the track. So we're good there, vocals just started. Here's a potential, but I'm going to mark out potential places for the chop. keep listening and decide whether I was right or wrong. Back in with If You Wanna Dance, that's going to work all right, so we can get rid of all of that, push that back. And acid quick fades the edges, so it's always worth, I don't know if your software does that, but it's always worth going in and checking out whether you're going to lose the front of that beat there. So, little crossfade. And that's going to sound a lot better, I think, so we'll have a listen. Sounds good. So, same process all the rest of the way through the track. Just listen and out. You can't lose this bit, this is the drop. Just let that whole chorus run. Potentially we can end here. Just undid that. I think that we probably want all of this. See from the waveform, there's a drop coming up now. Seems like we can get rid of this middle section. It's very important that the lyrics still make sense if at all possible. So, those two are going to fit just fine. Again, we'll go in and crossfade the edges. That seems to work. Back into the chorus. Some semblance of the start and the end of this without spending as long on it as I did the first time around. So, but the first bit of the first bit, so the drop's right, and the last bit of the last bit, so that it carries on in. I've got a bit of a problem with the words there. I think we brought back that "so make a wish" there, so that still makes sense. Important to keep a bit of the middle eight or the breakdown or whatever you want to call it, but dance teachers aren't looking for loads of that, especially as I'm presuming this is going to be kind of a beginner's thing. So the more beats the better, really. Birthday suit's going to prove to be a possibly a problem if you're using, if there's young kids, doesn't mean in the nude, I think. So I'm going to try and make it so that she says, "I'm going to bring out the big balloons instead." So let me get you, let me bring out the big balloons should work. And that's kind of the value we're bringing to the dance teacher, so she's not going to have that difficult conversation with the kids. Oh, there's something wrong there. A little bit out of time. Okay, that seems to work pretty good, and we've shortened the build-up as well, which is always a bit more tricky to choreograph. Into the last section now. It'll be a little bit over 2 minutes at that point, so it'd be good to possibly condense this again, like we did last time around in the last chorus section. And quite often I put a bang on the end of everything I do, but I know this song, and she says happy birthday at the end, which is a good opportunity for the choreographer, I'd have thought. So I think we'll just end it like that. That's so back. a little bit shorter time, so. And the same thing over and over again, so that seems probably bring us on budget time wise, and we'll just cross fade that last bit.
Happy birthday.
Just fade the end out so there's no clicks or pops. Okay, that sounds good, and we're out by about 2:04, so I'll make a little note of that duration as well. To be honest, it's a 2-minute edit. We're pretty much out by 2 minutes, so just save the file for my own sake. That's it. And then we're going to go for the render. So on streetdancemixes.com, when you're uploading, we're asking that everybody upload at 320 kbps mp3. So in your export settings, it'd be great if you can make sure that that's all set correctly. Save that out. Remember where you saved it and upload. And that's pretty much it. So that was how to shorten a popular song.
I heard you feeling nothing's going right.
Okay, so we're in acid. We're going to choose a song. I don't see nothing wrong with a little bump and grind, so we'll double click that, get that into the timeline. We're going to draw it out and have a look. And the first thing we're going to do is examine the waveform. So can we see any decent hit points in here that we could use to get rid of stuff? So if we want to shorten this down, we can immediately see that there are two sections that are pretty similar. One here at the start and one here maybe two-thirds of the way through. So I think what we'll do is we'll have a listen to that. The same thing here. And there we go. So those two are the same. So it means we can remove this entire midsection. So we'll do that now by zooming in and having a good look at the start of this vocal. We're going to go right tight to the very start where we see it just starting to appear. Probably about here. Split that there. And then move on to where that same section appears later on. And hopefully things will start to look pretty similar. Maybe this is where it starts. Something like that. So we'll split that as well. And now we should be able to remove this entire section. Drag this back, just go and have a little look and make sure that looks right. I'm just going to push that over there. This is called a crossfade with the in and the out, which just smoothens out the transition between the last piece of audio, the outgoing audio, and the incoming audio. So make sure that that's nice and clean. So we'll zoom out again, go back to the start and have a little listen and make sure that that's okay. Okay, that sounded absolutely fine. And so for argument's sake, I think that we will try and remove something from the middle of the track as well. Might be useful. What you're going to be doing here is counting the beats, which I'm sure you're all very used to as choreographers. And it's the 7/8 of a beat and then back to 1, and you're always going to cut just before that 1. So we'll just go through this again here. Just 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 1. So that 1 there, I'm going to zoom in on that 1. Okay, so we're going to go just before that 1 and make our cut. And then when we want to come back, we're going to do exactly the same thing. So goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1. Okay, so we're going to zoom in on that one and cut just before that one again. It's tight. It should look the same as the last one. It's the same kick drum. Okay, so we'll get rid of that. This section in the middle, we'll delete, push these two together, go back in, little crossfade to make sure that everything's nice and tidy. And hopefully this will sound like no one's ever been there. An invisible edit is what we're looking for, so let's have a listen. Okay, and that's got a reasonable ending on it. If you are stuck for an ending, it's always worth having a boom or something like that that's worth sticking in underneath, just so that we can let the audience know this routine has definitely finished now. I'm going to use one from a Busta Rhymes track that I know ends in a pretty big bang, so we'll stick that, and this is on another track now, and just try and level that up so that the bang goes off roughly where that ends. Get it nice and tight on that last beat, and that gives everyone the okay to start clapping and make sure that the kids know that we appreciate what they've done. So let's just put that in there like that and see if that gives us more of an idea that this show is now over. So that's okay, I probably should move that a little bit later. About the same distance that this one is from this one, it sort of wants to come in that bit after the beat, so we'll go with something like that. So we've got that one extra. Yep, that's it. That's definitely over now. Everyone's going to be applauding raucously. Okay, so next thing to do with this is export it. Now, we'll talk about this later, but I'm going to leave a couple of seconds of silence on the end of this file. This is going to help us out later on when we come to play out in the show. Basically, so that it doesn't, if you're in repeat, it doesn't go back to the start, or if you're going on to the next track, it gives you that little bit of time to think it through and press pause while the next lot are getting ready. Okay, so then we're talking about rendering the thing, and what we're gonna name it, save it somewhere to be included in our playlist for the show. A couple of things to point out about this. First thing is, make sure that it's all running about 0 dB. We don't want quiet stuff that we then have to turn up massively. So most things are recorded at 0 dB anyway, so you're going to be fine there, as long as within the mixer it's set at 0 dB as well. That is different for mixes, because obviously there's mix overs, and when two things are playing at the same time, things get that little bit louder, but this will be absolutely fine. And then it's about the quality we render at. Like I say, 256 kbps minimum for me, MP3. I like to save things out at 320. It's very difficult to tell the difference between that and a full WAV. So definitely go with that. If you're putting it out at 96 or whatever, it's going to have that horrible metallic crunchy sound to it. That's going to be annoying. So 320 kbps MP3 audio, and we will call that bump and grind show edit or something like that. Save that out to wherever that's going, and doesn't take too long, and that's it pretty much for that. So what we're going to do now is move on to running your show. So I guess there's three main options for show running that are doing the rounds at the moment. One's good old-fashioned CD, then creating a playlist in iTunes, and something I've been doing recently, which is arranging all your tracks in Microsoft PowerPoint. Now, they've each got their advantages and disadvantages. CD, it's reliable. You can bring a backup CD. And one of the advantages of this, if you've got some help, it keeps someone away from a laptop, so it's a job on its own, if that makes sense. I guess the downside with CD, if you want to make any last minute changes or reorder the show, anything like that, CD is obviously a fixed format, so it could get confusing, and quite often the CD player will just show the numbers on the front, so you haven't got a nice visual aid letting you know what the name of the next track is. Moving on, iTunes is cool because you can see the names. You can work from that one laptop, but it might not allow you to do visuals at the same time. Keep them both up and running. I know some people have some trouble getting their playlists in order in iTunes. Well, there's a reasonably simple trick, which is all about grouping. So what you do is head over to hit the track you want, hit get info, and then right here you see this that says grouping. You'll type 01 in track 1, 02 for track 2, 03 for track 3, etc., etc. And then when you come back to your playlist, you want to add the grouping column by clicking in the top, scrolling down, and making sure that grouping is checked. Then it will appear as a tab at the top, and when you click that, it will put them in either in order top to bottom or bottom to top each time you click it. So that's how you get your playlist for your dance show in order on iTunes. And last but not least, PowerPoint, which I really like because I've started using more and more video in shows, and it's also nice to put up text just before the class come on to say what the name of the piece is and what class they are. It saves people rustling their programs to check who's on now and who's on next, that sort of thing. So it gives the audience a kind of a running tally of what's going on in the show. So I like PowerPoint. It's quite easy to add music to each one of the tabs. So it means that it's one laptop, one person, one job. You can see it all triggers quite nicely. So I'm favouring PowerPoint, but they've each got their advantages. So last thing, I know it's not necessarily music, but I usually film every performance that we do. I film performances for other people as well. These days there's no excuse not to have a reasonably decent camera to point at the stage while this is going on, and it will work out well for you guys in terms of advertising your dance school for the ongoing year. So I saw this on eBay the other day. GoPro, £75, is quite a wide angle lens, so you can set that up near to the front of the stage and it should catch absolutely everything. It'll be a bit fish-eyed, but for £75, it'll sort its own lighting out and stuff like that. Can't be bad. And then get it in iMovie or whatever, choose a song, and get yourself a promo video out on YouTube. So this was something we did a couple of years back with the footage I took. So have a look at this and see what you think about this.
This Prince song inside my head. Hands up if you're down to get down tonight, 'cause it's always a good time. Slept in all my clothes like I didn't care. Hopped into a cab, take me anywhere. I'm in if you're down to get down tonight, 'cause it's always a good time.
Good morning and good
twilight. It's gonna be alright. We don't even have to try. It's always a good time.
Okay, so hopefully that's prompted a few more people joining that dance school if they've seen it on YouTube and they think, oh, they do look like they're having a good time. So moving on to licensing, that's the last section of my talk today. So I now know more about music licensing than I ever really wanted to. And in general, for dance teachers, well, it's not good news. The law prevents any reordering, remixing, speeding up, slowing down, or even fading out of a track without the copyright owner's permission being sought and given first. However, the kind of edits we've done today, if they're not for profit, will be covered under the venue's PPL license that they have for playout only. Now, how you decide whether you've profited from playing the music is anyone's guess, but if the venue has that PPL license, you should be fine. No one's going to come after you. Paid for edits and mixes is where we come in. So we've prepaid an eye-watering amount of money to get a raft of licenses from the collection agencies, which enable us to upload and sell mixes without the prior permission of those artists, on the understanding that we report out our track usage so that the artists get paid for their contribution to our dance events, if that makes sense. If you are getting good at mixing music for your own school or crew, then you can upload and download them from our site, and having listed the tracks that you've used, your music can be licensed privately for a nominal fee of £5, which helps us pay for our blanket license and leaves you safe in the knowledge that it's all totally legit, everything you've done is above board. So yeah, you just hit the private tab on the upload, nobody sees it, it doesn't go on sale, £5, that's now licensed, that's the way that that works. There's a real crackdown on copyright and piracy right now. A lot of new people getting into the game, a lot of collection agencies buying each other and jostling for position. And this might sound immodest, but I do honestly believe that streetdancemixes.com is here to save dance as we know it from endless bureaucracy and litigation from the labels and publishers. So if you're interested, check us out. I hope you've learned something from today. Thanks for joining me on this webinar. If you've got any questions, I'd love to hear them. So you can hit me up on inquiries@streetdancemixes.com is the email address. We've got a blog, Twitter, etc., etc. So yeah, I'd love to hear from you guys. Thank you very much to Dance Teacher Hub for hosting the event and inviting everyone along. And maybe we'll do another one day about mixing. That'd be cool. Have a great day. Thanks very much.